And the harvest field now ripened, there's a work for all to do. Hark, the voice of God is calling to that harvest, calling you. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. Does the place you're called to labor seem so small and little known? It is great if God is in it, and he'll not forget his own. Amen. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. Are you laid aside from service, body worn from toil and care? You can still be in the battle, in the sacred place of prayer. And little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. When the conflict here is ended and our race on earth is run, he will say, if we are faithful, welcome home, my child, well done. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name. Well, praise the Lord. It's good to be back today. Look forward to coming here, not just so I can see how well your pastor is dressing, and he does do a great job of dressing, but last time we were here, we were treated so well, and we were so blessed that we really didn't forget the visit that we had. I was looking forward to seeing your resident evangelist here today, but I guess he had the vacation from me, huh? Is that it? Well, I see a new face, and praise the Lord for that. For those who don't know me, a couple of new faces. My name is Tony Saxton, alias Chocolate Thunder, and my wife is Yvonne Brown Sugar Saxton. Amen. And we're glad to be back. Yvonne, in September 26th, she suffered a heart attack that led to a stroke, and led to multiple strokes, multiple seizures. And, you know, we tell people that the Lord brought us back from the valley of the shadow of death to a hospital bed, to a wheelchair, to a walker, and to a cane. And oftentimes I have to remind her, get your cane, babe, would you please?
Yeah.
And so we praise the Lord. We just know it just answered prayer. And then we had a few blurps along the way. I mean, you know, mistakes that were made. We found out after a while that the doctors during the angioplasty or angiogram, they had punctured one of her arteries, and she developed a pseudoaneurysm, mm-hmm. and that turned into a clot. And but praise the Lord, it didn't break off. Amen. We don't know if that even caused the stroke to begin with, but we're just rejoicing that God chose to leave her here with me. Now, she would be rejoicing more if God took her. Amen. But I'm glad. She is just needful to me. And I want to thank you for all your prayers and all the things that you did in supporting us, encouragement. Certainly is a blessing for us to be here. Hope we be a blessing to you. And my mission is to motivate, challenge, and encourage you in the way of evangelism if need be. Amen. The least we can do is be reminded of some things, and I don't have anything new for you. But take inventory. How are we doing? So, Father, we come before you this morning in the name of Christ, just thanking you and praising you, Lord, for this great opportunity, Lord, you give me to serve in the office of an evangelist. And God, I just pray, dear God, for the grace that is necessary for me to glorify you in this office. Lord, I certainly agree with the prayer my brother prayed earlier. And Lord, we just pray that we'll know today that we've been visited by you. Now, if there's any sin, God, in my heart, my mind, my life, or anybody in here, that might hinder us, dear God, from having fellowship, corporate fellowship with you. Lord, we just want to take maybe a few seconds and ask you, Lord, to forgive us and cleanse us. But we don't want anything to come between you. We want to abide in you and in your word. So as God leads, if there's anything you need spiritual cleansing from. Let's begin. I just want to talk to you about the who, the what, the when, the where, the why, and the how of evangelism. Many of you probably noticed already that I like that outline. One reason why the who, what, when, where, why, and how is because it's simple, and I'm a simple man. It's very, very popular, amen? And, you know, it typically asks and answers the most common questions, and it also can be, this method of teaching can also be very comprehensive. It can cover a lot of ground, amen? And so if there's any other question that I might miss out, something you might want to interject. Matter of fact, I'm looking forward to interaction this morning. Amen? And so let's get right on to it. What is evangelism? Now, that's a question I'm looking for an answer from. What is evangelism? I need a definition of it. What is evangelism? Help me out here.
Well, there is a verse, brother, about the feet. Blessed are the feet of them that take...
Amen. Romans 10:17.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. To preach the gospel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay. That's a good definition. That'll work for me. Anybody else?
Yeah. So go out to make disciples of all men, teaching them what I've taught you. And that, so they have going out to...
Man, can I have that accent? Can I have that accent? Praise the Lord.
He's
Matthew 28.
He's a drama major.
Oh, is he?
And he's practiced that. He's putting that on for you.
Do you dance too, brother?
I do.
Whoa, man. Do you sing too?
Well, not pretty well, but I do sing.
That's all right. Make a joyful noise.
This
sister here's got some rhythm too. I saw her back there clapping off of that song. Amen. You got to make it happen sometime, right? So well, praise the Lord. But let me give you what I have. The word evangelism comes from a Greek word, evangel. Amen? Mm-hmm. And an evangelist is someone who preaches or teaches the good news of the king and his kingdom. Mm-hmm. Amen? The Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? Are you an evangelist? I'm asking you. Are you an evangelist? Keep it in mind, evangelist is one. And you know, oftentimes we think of being evangelist, we automatically think of the office of an evangelist. I'm not asking you that. I'm asking you, are you an evangelist? One who evangelizes. Mm-hmm. That's going to lead to the next question. Who is an evangelist? An evangelist is someone who evangelizes. Doesn't get any simpler than that. Mm. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay. In a general sense, all Christians are called. All are capable, and what's so funny? And all are commissioned. Mm. All are commissioned. All Christians are called. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
The moment you get saved, you're called. You're called to be an evangelist. All are capable. God makes you capable. He will never call you to do something and equip you to do. Yes. And amen. And all are commissioned to evangelize. You know, there's said to be five separate commissions, great commissions in the Word of God. And the one that's most popular is Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. Amen. And we ought to have that memorized if we don't. Amen. And most people do. All power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you.
Yes, sir.
And lo, I am with you all the way to the end of the age. Now that's the last command, amen? Amen? From the great commander, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he didn't suggest that we do this. He commanded us to. As a matter of fact, that's why he left us here to finish his work. Amen? Isn't that true?
Yes, sir.
And he said to occupy until I come back. You see, our mission is to follow Christ and his mission. He came from the kingdom, amen, down into the world, amen, to raise up kingdom citizens and to give his work to his body.
Yeah.
for us to carry on the work. He didn't give the work to angels.
No.
Or any other entity. The only aliens he gave it to is us. We're pretty strange. Well, I am, brother. I confess. And so, who is an evangelist? Well, the people in the pew. Mm-hmm. Amen. The ones who don't have titles. Mm-hmm. Does that ring a bell? Sheep make sheep.
Yeah.
Amen. I mean, if a church is going to grow, it's because the people in the pew understand that. You know, I've been a pastor. I'm sorry, I didn't tell you. For some of you who don't know, I was a pastor for 20 years in the inner city of Rochester, New York. Amen. And pretty rough place, but praise the Lord. You know, God gave us grace.
Amen.
And for 20 years. And now I'm an evangelist with the heart of a pastor, having been a pastor. And so I know about that. I know about big churches, small churches. Amen.
Yeah.
You know, I know about church problems, church issues. And I've never been more burdened for pastors and for churches than I am right now. Mm-hmm. Amen. Yeah. And so, you know, when I say the things I'm saying, I qualify the things that I say with some of the things that I've done. Mm. Amen. And I know I know firsthand that a church grows when other people go out and bring other people in. Mm-hmm. Sheep make sheep. You know, I tell you, it's just funny. Now I can do this. I got liberty.
Yes.
We saw some horses making horses yesterday, didn't we, babe?
Yeah.
I'm moving on. But anyhow, who is evangelist? The pastor in the pulpit.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Responsibility is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. What's the work of the ministry? It's the edifying of the body of Christ. Building up the body of Christ, not only numerically, but especially. He's not bothering me. If he's bothering you, that's fine. He's not bothering me at all. Okay, he cannot out-talk me. But anyhow, you know, it's to equip the saints for the building up, the edifying of the body of Christ. And so he is to teach you. It's to teach you how to do your part in building up the body, spiritually, especially spiritually. And then numerically will take care of after the spiritual is, amen. When you become more like Christ, then no one will have to tell you.
That's right.
Amen. Yeah. No one will have to convince you. You want to.
Yes.
Amen. And so his major responsibility now is to do that. But it not only teach from the pulpit, but by example. Mm-hmm. And say, listen, come on, follow me as I follow the Lord. I tell you what, the times that I went, especially in my early age, days as a Christian, going soul winning, mm-hmm. or winning souls, or evangelizing with my pastor, mm-hmm. well, it was a joy just to watch him, mm-hmm. amen, and to see him work. And I learned more that way. You learn more OJT. Now, you can learn lessons in a book. Mm-hmm. You can learn the Romans road, you can learn the Baptist road, and be careful that Baptist road. Mm-hmm. You don't want to make converts, you know, but anyhow.
That's right.
Hmm. Isaiah Road, you know, all these different roads, the way of the master, you know, these different techniques of winning souls. But boy, I tell you what, it's nothing like OJT. On the job training. Mm-hmm. Amen. You got to get out there. You get more grace. Amen. Amen. You get great burdens too. That's when the burden comes. I'm not burdened for souls. Well, you got to get out there.
Yeah, that's true. I got a question for you.
Yes.
I just ran into a man I was talking with, of course. And he was a lifestyle evangelist.
Yes, and we all should be, but go ahead.
Well, I mean, he didn't believe in telling anybody anything. He just believed standing around that they'd get the news. I said,
that's contrary to Scripture.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
That's right.
That's contrary to Scripture.
I said, how did the people tell you from somebody else that's just standing there too? What do you get? What kind of information are you gaining from these people?
That's his own method, and I guarantee you, God might let it work. But not too often.
Wow.
All right. Who should evangelize? It's the preacher that is called to the office of an evangelist. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Evangelist not only what I do, it should be who I am. Mm-hmm. Amen. It should characterize my entire life. Amen. God is giving me a gift as a gift to the church. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yes.
To teach evangelism. To be an evangelist, you know, to be able to confront people with my lifestyle and with my lips.
Yeah. Amen. Wow.
Amen. Amen. You know, it gives me the ability to stand before people and with a great deal of effectiveness and ease. Mm-hmm. My responsibility is to cultivate that gift and take advantage of the opportunity that God gives. Like today, I'm here to motivate, challenge, and encourage you. Come on, let's go. Amen.
Amen.
You know, my job, my ministry as an evangelist, I'm not turning a lot of scriptures for the sake of time, but you can turn to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11. We talked about this last time I was here. I try to keep abreast of what I talked to you last time on, or any time I come. My wife said, make sure you don't give them the same message like, you know, that you do if you're not careful. But anyhow, as we define, you know, the ministry of an evangelist and one in the office, the Bible clearly tells us that the Lord gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. You know, so gifted men, he's given to the church. Why? For the perfecting or the equipping or the training of the saints for the work of the ministry, which is the edifying of the body of Christ, both numerically and spiritually. Until we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, what man? Unto the measure and the stature of the fullness of Christ. Amen?
Yep.
That we henceforth do be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie wait to deceive, but speaking the truth of love in love may grow up in him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. So my ministry as an evangelist is not only to evangelize, amen, but it's to help the pastor build up the church.
Amen.
Yeah, sir.
Okay.
I know he dresses better than me. He might be a little bit more handsome too. But when you get a pastor and evangelist working together as a team, and both of them know what their responsibility is, you know, my responsibility is not to blow in, blow up, and blow out.
No.
It's to bow in, build up.
Amen.
Pastor, hope I helped you.
Amen.
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 I mean, when you get that team working together, to edify the body, to build up the body, both numerically and spiritually. Amen. Your responsibility is to stay home. Manage their lives, bring them up. I'm better at moving around. I know that after 20 years, amen. You know, but God gives you grace. You ask my wife, you know, how do you feel about being a pastor, evangelist wife as opposed to a pastor's wife? I'm free. Praise the Lord, I'm free. She laughed. But it's true. And she said, Tony, we had grace in that office. Mm-hmm. But now we got grace, joy, peace.
Wow.
Yeah. God allowed us to suffer through the pastor. No, we all suffer through. I mean, every one of us suffers. Amen. Mm-hmm. But he was preparing me for what I'm doing right now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I've never felt as much joy. And so that's the office of an evangelist. When should you evangelize? Let me give you four things here, and you're very familiar with this. Be ready always. What does that mean, to be ready always? Somebody help me.
In season, out of season?
Well, that's another verse. Amen. But that's the same thing. That's the same thing. That'll be a great cross-reference. Let's take time to look at a couple of these verses that we're familiar with. Most of us, anyhow. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. So, when should you evangelize? Well, I'm glad you asked. But sanctify the Lord God in your heart and be ready always. Somebody say, be ready always.
Be ready always.
To give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is which is in you with meekness and trembling, or meekness and fear. You should always be ready for someone to ask you about the reason of the hope of the eternal life that you have, the hope that you have of a better day, the hope you have in this life.
Amen.
Amen. The expectation. You see, hope for a Christian is different for an unsaved person, because hope for a Christian is expectation.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Be ready always to give to sanctify the Lord God in your heart. That means just give your heart to God. That's how you prepare to give somebody an answer. You just give your heart to God. You don't have to turn there, but in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17, it says this. Paul prayed that God would strengthen him, strengthen us with might by his spirit in the inner man, that Christ might dwell or abide in our hearts by faith.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
In other words, that Christ, when you get saved, Christ, the Spirit of Christ is resident in your life.
Yes, sir.
Amen?
Amen.
Well, God, the Lord wants to be more than resident. He wants to be president. Mm.
Mm-hmm.
And when the Lord is president in your life, nobody has to tell you that you need to evangelize.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right.
Because the Lord is in control of your heart. He'll do the work through you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You'll recognize opportunities. That's what you're going to be living for.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why Peter, the Apostle Peter, said, listen, sanctify the Lord God in your heart. Set your heart apart for God.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you what, if you don't set your heart apart for God, you'll set it apart for something or someone else.
Wow. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's right.
And who better? So anyhow, be ready always. Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason to hope that's in you with meekness and fear, with gentleness. You know, we ought not to be beating people over the head with the Bible.
Mm.
Especially nowadays.
Mm. Wow.
People are easily offended, man. You might get shot.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, people, I tell you more and more, you know, and I'm so glad that God has really blessed me with the opportunity to allow my ministry to be characterized by talking about the love of God.
Wow.
Amen.
Because people are hurting.
Yeah.
You know, because of the problem that we have all of our lives, and you might not have to dig deep to consider this. We grow up looking for love in all the wrong places.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah, there's truth to that.
We look for love. It's another message. But anyhow, with meekness. Meekness is the gentleness of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And with fear, mm-hmm. or in awe of God, mm-hmm. with a reverential respect and trust for God.
Mm.
And his word. Amen. We're going to be careful with the word of God and how we use the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
You say, well, are you going to be running to confrontation? Yes, you are. But listen, when you have those confrontations, and I had one 2 weeks ago. Let me tell you this real quick. I was in a barbershop, and there's this guy that's into this Eastern religion stuff. And as soon as I come in, you know, Rev, what's up? What about this? What about that? You know, and we started going on and on. And then there was another guy, another barber, and he was very intellectual, and he was listening. And that guy, he made me think, but I had to think before I responded, mm-hmm. thinking and praying and responding.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I left, the young barber, the one that's really involved in Eastern stuff, and I think the other guy is even more involved than him. Mm-hmm. He doesn't let on.
Mm-hmm.
He just listens.
Mm-hmm.
And when I left, the young kid says, Pastor Tony, I love you.
Mm.
And I said, do you know what love is? And I was glad I had to leave, because I don't think I was ready to respond then.
Mm.
Well,
but I came back 2 weeks later. I came in yesterday. And I said, I want everybody in the barbershop to hear me. It's about 20 people,
mm.
15, 20 people. They know when I come in, they're going to get preached to. They welcome it. And I got an amen corner over here, and I got listeners over here. I got another guy getting ready to mess up somebody's hair over here. And I said, does anybody know what love is?
Mm-hmm.
Said, oh, yeah, love is this. And I said, I mean true love.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, and then when I said, listen, God is love.
Amen.
Yeah.
You know, God, love does not define God. God defines love.
Yes.
I mean, that's true love. His love is supernatural, mm-hmm. sacrificial,
oh.
selfless, immeasurable, perfect, everlasting love.
Yeah.
And the only way you can be able to really express God's love. Mm-hmm. I mean, the only way you're going to be able to express God's love, you have to experience His love.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Embrace that love. Mm-hmm. Keep yourself there. Amen. With unbroken fellowship. Continue to experience that love. He calls it abiding. So then you can express His love. God's love, not man's love. Mm-hmm. And so then I started talking about the who, the what, the when, the where, the why, and the how of the love of God. Mm-hmm. And after I got done, he cut my hair. I said, "You didn't have much to say today." He said, "Pastor Tony, you were right on the money."
Mm-hmm. Amen.
What did I say? Confrontation. You're going to have it. Mm-hmm. But when you stand in defense of the gospel, don't do it with vainglory.
Wow.
Or for vainglory.
Yeah.
So that you can lift yourself up and say, "I won this battle." God is not in that.
True.
I mean, once I witnessed to a Jehovah Witness, and I beat her down. I mean, that she was down to the ground. I mean, I just crushed her. I made her so bitter. Mm-hmm. I hardened her heart for the next person.
Yeah. Wow.
Yes, sir.
That was a woman I've known for a lot of years. I think she's a feminist. But on Facebook, we were discussing something, and she piped in and said, "Dave, where's the love?" And I wrote back, John 3:16.
Mm-hmm. You got to express it. And you know, people recognize genuine love because, man, it's right in the core of the heart, and it's energized by the Spirit of God. Mm-hmm. You know, I sing in public. And when I start singing about the love of God, people respond. If the spirit's controlled, sometimes it's in the flesh, and you know, I admit it. Don't mean for it to be, because sometimes the flesh can make you think you're doing spiritual things.
Wow.
Right. Yeah.
It's always still in the glory, trying to. Mm-hmm. But boy, if it's in the spirit, it penetrates the heart. You know, I was talking to our missions director at church about, singing evangelism and doing it seasonal, Christmas, Valentine's Day, mm-hmm. you know, Easter. And I tell you, that's effective because it penetrates people's hearts. And so I see you taking notes. Be ready always. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. Here's a powerful one. Proverbs chapter 22, verses 17 through 21. We've got to go there. And I'm going to edit because we've got to get done. Proverbs, and this is another familiar portion of Scripture for some of us. Mm-hmm. Proverbs chapter 22. Boy, I miss, what's his name, the evangelist there?
John Bailey.
Bailey, how can we forget Bailey? My wife was just talking about him the other day because of that movie, amen? And because of fellowship we had with him. Mm-hmm. And Proverbs is still here somewhere, I think. Let's see. I really need a Bible with tabs on it now because I keep fumbling all over the place instead of going right to where I need to be going. I don't know if that's true for you. Maybe it's just a sign of my getting a little bit older.
Amen.
And so Proverbs chapter 22 verse 17, "Bow down thine ear and hear the words of the wise, and apply thine heart unto my knowledge. Sanctify his word in your heart. For it is a pleasant thing if you keep them within thee in your heart, they shall be withal be fitted in your lips." Out of the mouth, the heart. Mm-hmm. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. "Why? That thy trust may be in the Lord. I have made known to thee this day, even to thee. Have not I written unto thee excellent things in counsels and knowledge, that I might make thee to know the certainty of the words of truth, that thou mayest answer the words of truth to them that send unto thee?" In other words, God teaches us these words of truth. Mm-hmm. And he says, hide them in your heart. Yep. Amen? Mm-hmm. That you might know them and understand, be able to speak them.
Wow.
Why? So that you'll be able to answer somebody that I send to you. Mm-hmm. God will send people to you. You see, that verse is really cross-references to 1 Peter chapter 3.
Mm. It does.
God will send people in your path for you to tell them about the gospel, especially if you ask him. And this is the question I ask you is when? Well, be always ready. You know, be ready for when God sends somebody to you. Mm-hmm. When you're led by the Spirit of God will lead you to witness to people. You know, he spoke to me very clearly the other day when I was in the room. I had prayed earlier that day for somebody to witness to. And it was a young man that was working at the place with me. And I just started talking about the love of God. And I showed him this video on the Father's love letter. You got to see that if you've never seen it. But anyhow, and started talking to him about, you know, you're saved and how you need to be discipled and so on. And the words are just fine. But I knew that the Spirit of God spoke to me, our heart. And listen, when the Spirit of God speaks to you about witness to somebody,
yeah,
don't quench the Spirit.
Mm.
That's right.
Be ready. Be instant. Quenching the Spirit means putting out the fire.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
You will grieve it.
Yeah, yeah.
And you might find that you won't have as many opportunities in the future.
Whoa. Mm-hmm.
How we doing, folks? When somebody asks you to go witness to somebody for them. Someone asked me 2 weeks ago. I've been preaching in Oswego. And a brother that's kind of managing the church while they're waiting for a pastor, and they lost their pastor. He called me and said, Pastor Tony, we've got a lady that's going up in the hospital. She's got cancer. Would you go and talk to her about Jesus?
Mm.
Amen. I did.
Yeah.
What an opportunity. Mm-hmm. And I walked in. I said, let me introduce myself to you. My name is Chocolate Thunder. And she says, what? Don't introduce yourself like that. But it worked for me. Where should you evangelize? Let me hurry here. Use your sanctified imagination on this, okay? And consider this. I'm going to give you one verse, Acts chapter 1. Sanctify imagination means, you know, your Holy Ghost imagination. Okay. And let me give you a scripture. It says that you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses of me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. Now, I want to use got phraseology, not geographically, but personally. Your Jerusalem. What could constitute your Jerusalem? Your home. Start at home. Start with your spouse. Start with your children. Start with your grandchildren. I mean, if we don't, then we could really easily be considered hypocrites.
Well,
yeah.
Start in your home.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, I tell you what, that would bless God. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, one of the reasons why he placed you in that family and saved you in that family is so that you could be a witness to that family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Your Jerusalem, your in-laws, your grands, your Judea, you know, for the sake of sanctified imagination, you know, let's look at that as being those outside of your family. You know, how about those in the sphere of your influence? You know, no accident that God gave you the job that he gave you. Not only accident that he put you in the school that he put you in. You know, there's no accident that he put you in this particular neighborhood.
Hmm.
I finally got her to say something. She's been nodding. Now she said something. No accident, is it, young lady?
That's right. Yeah.
That's God's way of taking the gospel everywhere.
Wow.
Through you. You just Jerusalem, your Judea, your Samaria. Let's just say this is maybe this might be the government. your country abroad, or, you know, maybe supporting other outreaches, you know, places that you can't go within your own country. And then as the uttermost, we consider the uttermost, you know, we're talking about the continents. You may not want to go, you may not be able to go, but you can send. That's where missions come in. Amen? I mean, we can go to the uttermost, we can go to the most remote places to evangelize to other people. By being a part of that work and faithfully supporting them. You know, I understand clearly. You know, I used to think what people would say, well, your prayer is more important than the finances. And I used to think, yeah, right. Well, now I realize that. You can't put a premium on prayer.
That's right.
Wow.
That's the truth.
You see that nice little car, that car we had?
Yeah.
You see how nice it was? Yeah, we got that.
Yeah.
Prayer of the Saints.
Yeah.
Man, I crawled into Finger Lakes. And then dressed right by the church that preached on Weir.
Mm.
And we crawled into Finger Lakes. Last year God gave me a 1995 Oldsmobile Cutlass station wagon. Mm-hmm. I had a problem with that. Mm. Pride. A little rusted out and everything. You know, I didn't look too good in that, all scorched up. The year before, he gave me a Cadillac.
Yeah.
You remember that caddy?
I remember the Cadillac.
It was in the driveway for a year. I couldn't afford to get it fixed.
Yeah.
Well, anyhow, we crawled to this church in Finger Lakes 2 weeks ago. And we just barely made it. I didn't want anybody to come. I just figured if it gets broke down because of her condition, I didn't want her to get.
Hmm.
And I mentioned that in church. And then after the church, after the service, a guy comes up to me and said, God spoke to my heart, told me to give you one of my cars.
Hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Hmm.
And then, you know, immediately, I just felt in my spirit that God was saying, listen, I answered your wife's prayer.
Wow.
It's almost like it wasn't your prayer, it was your wife's. And so I didn't even tell her. I said, okay, let me see if this is from the Lord. I didn't even tell her that I had the car.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I waited till I got home. Mm-hmm. And I said, baby, how did you pray? I said, I prayed that God would get you there, get you back, and then he would get us another vehicle.
Yeah.
I said, well, he did. She said, I didn't expect him to answer that quickly.
Yeah. Amen.
You know, that testified to me that he wanted me to do this. Otherwise, I wouldn't be in Ithaca today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so, how are we doing? The who? Well, the what? What is evangelism? It's, you know, let me just kind of review and then what we've done. That worked out really good, time-wise. Do you have any questions? What is evangelism? Comes from a Greek word. Evangelist is someone who preaches or teaches and or teaches the good news of the king and his kingdom. The Lord Jesus Christ. Are you an evangelist? Jesus was the greatest evangelist ever lived. Amen.
Amen.
Who is an evangelist? Evangelist is one who evangelizes. In general sense, all Christians are called, capable, and commissioned to evangelize. Are the people in the pew, the pastor in the pulpit, and the preacher in the office. Why should you evangelize? When should you evangelize? Always ready. Be ready when God sends somebody to you. Be ready when you're led of the Spirit. Be instant in season, out of season. Mm-hmm. When somebody asks you to.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I never will forget this Italian friend of mine, Joe Lou, probably the craziest pothead in the place at Kodak. Well, mm-hmm. That's a big place. It wasn't that bad. I'm exaggerating a little bit. But he was, man, even after he got saved, it was crazy, because I remember my deacon, who was my boss at work, and I was his pastor. He came to me one day and he said, you know, Pastor, you need to go talk to Brother Joe. This is after he received Christ.
Mm.
And he said, he's either spirit-filled or he's high as a jay bird. Well, he was high as a kite. And that's what I told him. I said, listen, man, now that you're saved, man, some of these things, they got to go.
That's right.
Otherwise, it's going to ruin your testimony. He said, you know, you're right, Pastor, because my wife doesn't want anything to do with me because I still smoke the wacky weed. But I tell you what, he's one of the most faithful soldiers I've ever seen today.
Wow.
Amen. Amen. Where should you evangelize? Your Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, uttermost parts of the world. And the why. And that leads us into the next message. Hmm. Why? We're talking about motives for evangelism. Mm-hmm. Brother, I'm done. And that's, is that right on time? 1 minute off. Okay.
Amen. All right, let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for the blessings. You're so good to us. And we just continue to thank you for how you take care of us. And thank you for being able to be used of you to tell others about Jesus Christ and continue to use us. And we'll thank you for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right, time to get up and stretch a little bit.